Inner Traditions Audio presents Mysteries of the Taos Caves, The Lost Civilizations Where the Andes Meet the Amazon, by Alex Chionetti, read by Luke Bob Robinson. Foreword. May we not be ashamed of the future. Half a century ago, while the world was concentrating on its television screens to see the arrival of the first man on the moon, in an office in the Ecuadorian city of Guayaquil, there was a scene from another world. On that July 21, 1969, an Argentine citizen of Hungarian origin named Janos Juan Morich made public a testimony that revealed him to be the discoverer of a network of artificial tunnels created by an unknown civilization that lay under a good part of Ecuador. That document can be heard in the contents of Chapter 4. That notarized document not only referred to a colossal infrastructure hitherto unpublished in the so-called civilized world, but also mentioned a collection, a library, rather, of metal and gold plates whose knowledge and exotic motifs represented the culture of its builders. From his testimony, it was clear that Morich did not seek ownership of that treasure, but only recognition and protection of what he considered a finding of unimaginable cultural value. The unstable political situation of Ecuador in those years left Morich's pleas for preservation unheard. A man of overwhelming personality, of a fiery and impatient nature, Morich despaired at the inaction of the authorities. As the weeks went by, he retired into business and left the matter into the hands of his lawyer, Gerardo Peña Mathias. It was through him that Erich von Däniken, the celebrated author of Chariots of the Gods, 1968, contacted Morich. Von Däniken reconstructed Morich's history, met with collateral witnesses such as the Saliceian priest Carlo Crespi, who had been receiving bronze and gold plates from the natives of Cuenca for years as those of the caves, and wrote a book that would turn Morich's discovery into something of world interest, The Gold of the Gods, 1972. Incredible as it may seem, in September 2018, the embers of this affair were still hot. The idea that these plates formed a kind of lost library of humanity, in which it was not difficult to find remote representations of Egyptian and even Phoenician or Babylonian origin, was still the subject of debate in publications, congresses, and social networks. What people, when, and for what purpose, made those engraved plates and hid them in the equatorial depths? In the end, no one really knows. Morich seemed capable of providing a sensible response. He spoke of the taltos, a Hungarian term to refer to some mysterious superior beings that created our species. He even suggested that their writing resembled the Magyar of his native land. Others, however, began to talk about intraterrestrials. In the absence of government explorations, most eventually ignored the issue. In a personal effort to reconstruct what happened 5 decades ago, I visited Cuenca, Ecuador. Of the collection of Father Crespi, there was no longer any trace. I interviewed journalists from the newspaper El Comercio and some interested writers and managed to meet with the only living witness of the dilemma that still remained alive in Guayaquil, the lawyer Don Gerardo Peña Mathias. Peña Mathias was a gentleman, just as he had been portrayed by those who write about the mysteries of the caves. The literate octogenarian picked me up in the lobby of the Windhall Hotel, where I was staying, and sat at his desk to explain in detail what happened in the 60s. In the heat of some whiskies, we remembered Morich, who died in February 1991. He told me about Morich's passion for archaeology and old books, and he confirmed the frustration that Morich took to the grave for failing to turn his find into something of official importance. The natives of the region where he found the galleries commissioned him to protect the legacy they showed him, he told me. For them, those galleries were a heritage of their remote ancestors, a treasure to protect. Peña Mathias and his charming wife, Mariana, did not let me doubt for a moment that a treasure is still hidden underground beneath Ecuador. Listening to them rekindled my memory of other adventurers who later wanted to emulate Morich's steps, such as Andreas Faber-Kaiser or Alex Chionetti. Faber-Kaiser visited the region in the 80s alone, without speleological equipment or the training to achieve his purpose. Before his death in 1994, Faber-Kaiser told me that he trusted that he would be initiated by the Shuar community, which to this day guards the main entrance to that network of tunnels, and perhaps that they would lead him to the metal library that the caves shelter. He did not get the initiation he had hoped for. The Shuar only allowed him to approach the mouth of the entrance, a vertical chasm of more than 200 feet of freefall, with the warning that he should be very careful to hold his tongue. Janos and I warned him that he might not get out of the Shuar territory alive, Peña Mathias told me, his eyes burning with passion. That look, by the way, was the same that I had seen years before in the face of Alex Chionetti when he told me again and again of his own determination to vindicate the history and discovery of Morich. Chionetti has dedicated almost four decades to this endeavor. He has traveled half the world looking for the threads of this hiding place, and he has interviewed the protagonists and drawn his own conclusions. But above all, his quest has been armed with courage and determination to explore, measure, and even film that underground world in Ecuador that today experts know as the Cuevas de los Tayos, the Tayos Caves. I remember that while I was the director of the important Spanish monthly magazine Más Allá de la Ciencia, Beyond Science, Alex tried to persuade me several times to do a thorough follow-up on the subject. I only half listened, and now I regret it. After my recent encounter with Peña Mathias in Guayaquil, the efforts of some journalists, including mine, to locate the Crespi collection, and my conversations with modern local scholars such as Manuel Palacios, I have no doubt now that we are dealing with a topic of importance. The controversy that surrounds these caves is the logical consequence of a full-fledged archaeological enigma, perhaps the last of the great mysteries whose origins remain to be discovered. From my point of view, it matters little whether it was a controversial author such as von Däniken who linked the galleries to an extraterrestrial situation and who made the caves a public issue, or that the authorities of Ecuador continue to turn their back on what was discovered by Morich and protected by Crespi. The case is still there, open to the eyes of the world. Alex Chionetti's endeavors, like those of a flesh-and-blood Indiana Jones, serve as reminders to us. Hopefully, our generation does not have to be ashamed before our children and grandchildren for not managing a heritage such as the one that this book claims. Final note: history is almost always capricious, Neil Armstrong, the man who, on July 21, 1969, was taking his first steps on the moon while Janos Morich signed his famous testimony, came to visit the caves of Taos on a predestined day in July 1970.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.